O'Byrne is here with us during our Doc to Doc for the Central Florida Behavioral Health Hub today to do a presentation. She's one of the pediatric residents. So I'll let you take it away, Dr. O'Byrne.
Thank you, Dr. Spector. So before starting my DBP rotation, I was aware that sometimes it was a bit difficult to give an ADHD diagnosis, especially for young school age children, just as they're entering school and kind of teasing out if it's really ADHD or just they're a very excited kid still in their toddler phase, kind of growing and developing. But one of the patients we had also brought up some, I guess, questions that I wasn't aware of, that sometimes the symptoms of ADHD can overlap with ASD, especially in young females, since that is not always the population that we see these symptoms manifest in. And so for some background, the patient we saw, she was a four-year-old female. Her family began to have concerns for ASD soon after birth. The mom has a sister with severe ASD, and so she was very aware of kind of red flag signs. And so she noticed that her child did not make eye contact very well. She didn't track them with her eyes as a baby. She did not respond to her name until about 2.5 years old. And she frequently repeats lines that she hears in cartoons, regardless of the situation, sometimes to self-soothe, and she'll try to match emotions of the characters to how she's feeling in real life. Things of note, she did get an adenoidectomy this past May for recurrent AOM, and parents noticed that her language dramatically increased and improved since then, and then they enrolled her into VPK, and they noticed that she had improved socialization. Her teachers had no concerns about her interacting with her peers, and so they really credit that adenoidectomy as kind of like the benchmark for this rapid improvement. So when they came to see us, they now also had concerns for ADHD-like symptoms. They noticed that when she was meeting these new peers, if it was the first time she saw another child, she would get so overexcited that it was kind of hard to hear her. It was almost like she was speaking faster than her brain could catch up. And then she really engaged in different activities and toys, but sometimes she would change it very rapidly if it was no longer maintaining her interest. And so just kind of a brief overview of the different criteria for ADHD and autism. So for ADHD, we will usually use the Vanderbilt assessment scales for screening. I know in our continuity clinic here, that's a big thing we give to parents. We give them to take home, and then we can always follow up on an additional visit. And so it's very important that it's filled out by both parents, and it's usually teachers or in a different setting. So sometimes if a child spends a good portion of their time with, say, grandparents and then at home with the parents, then those two can fill it out. But we do really want to see two different settings, because in order to diagnose it, the symptoms must be present for 6 or more months in 2 or more settings. And so in order to get a positive screen, you need a positive score on at least 6 items on either the first 9 questions, which assesses the inattentive subtype, and at least 1 positive score on some of the performance questions, and or a positive score on at least 6 items on the second 9 questions, which addresses the hyperactive subtype, and at least 1 positive score on performance questions. And so some common symptoms that families or teachers might bring up for the inattentive type, it's really the lack of attention to details. Teachers notice a lot of careless mistakes on homework, does not seem to listen when spoken to directly, has difficulty following through with directions or tasks, and is forgetful in daily activities. And then the hyperactive symptoms, it's very fidgety with hands and feet, squirms in seat, difficulty sitting still, they talk too much, sometimes they interrupt others' conversations and activities, and they have difficulty waiting their turn. And so symptoms must start before 12 years old in order to be diagnosed. but there's still a question about whether there's a minimum age to diagnose. But working with Dr. Spector and just kind of in order to have that second environment, most aren't diagnosed until about 4 years old or when they enter school. And then usually they're diagnosed by like 16, again, because it affects their schoolwork so much. And then for the autism, usually the main screening we use at outpatient visits, they get the MCHAP questionnaire at 18 and 24 months of well-child visits. And then if anything were to be positive on that, they would do additional questioning and screening. And then we would refer them to someplace like DBP, where you can do a more intensive evaluation. And so the one that we use with Dr. Spector's office is the Autism Diagnostic Observation Schedule, or the ADOS-2, and they have 5 different modules based on age and development. And so if a patient has some additional developmental concerns, sometimes their numerical age would not be the most appropriate module to give them, and so we can scale it based on that. For our patient, she was module 2. And then in order to be diagnosed, they must have deficits in all 3 areas of social, communication, and interaction. So that's the social emotional reciprocity. Can the child recognize when we're feeling a certain emotion and kind of regulate themselves to that? Their nonverbal communication, so eye contact, body language, things like that. And then developing, maintaining, and understanding relationships. So is the child interested in establishing a rapport with the provider, kind of having that back and forth conversation to kind of get to know them better? And then kind of based on parent report, do they have an interest in interacting with their peers, establishing friendships, things like that? And then patients with ASD usually also have these restricted, repetitive, and perseverative interests and behaviors. So kind of what we think about stereotypically about a child with autism spectrum disorder is they have a lot like body rocking, hand flapping. They have a very niche interest, and they might not always like play with toys the way we would expect them to. So instead of driving cars around, they're more interested in like spinning the wheels or lining them up. And some of the manifestations that parents will first see is kind of that poor eye contact. They might not engage in play the way some of their other children have, or that they would imagine it to be, especially functional or imaginative play. Sometimes their children really struggle to pretend to be like a chef or a doctor or something like that, where it has to imagine stepping into a different role. And then again, it can be diagnosed at any age, but symptoms do start to be noticed by family around 2 years old, kind of as they're now becoming more social creatures, entering school and interacting with other people. So going back to our case, on the actual ADOS evaluation, it was very interesting. Our child had kind of a decent amount of both type of symptoms that it was hard to tease out. She was interested in engaging with us during the evaluation, but sometimes she found it hard to maintain eye contact, have reciprocal conversations. Kind of again, like once she got almost tired of the conversation, it became very hard for her to ask additional questions or kind of still engage in that conversation. She was very interested in the different activities and toys, but sometimes it did take a lot to switch her to the next activity because she became a little bit perseverative with that one activity. For example, Dr. Spector mentioned that the Jack-in-the-Box toy, she became very focused on making sure that the jack always went back in the box, and it was very hard to switch from that toy to the next activity. Sometimes it was hard for her to engage in imaginative play. When Dr. Spector asked her to treat a block as an airplane, she was very adamant that it was not an airplane. She was like, no, this is a block. What are we doing? But with the birthday party, She was very good about imagining that the baby doll was an actual child and having a birthday, and she was very engaged in that activity. She was a very active child. She found it very hard to sit still. Even at the beginning of the evaluation, she was walking around the room, even when parents were sitting on the couch. She was constantly up and down, but some of those movements were more repetitive than just simple hyperactivity. She would kind of rock herself back and forth or kind of like bounce in place, and then she had some hand flapping as well. And then she didn't have too much echolalia, but she did have those specific phrases or words that she would repeat throughout the visit as well. And so scoring her, she did score a 9 on the ADOS, which put her right at the cusp, kind of pushed her over the edge. The cutoff was an 8. And so talking to family, we did agree to move forward with the autism spectrum disorder diagnosis for today, just to get her connected to more resources, especially ABA therapy. But we did mention that it doesn't completely rule out the fact that she may develop ADHD in the future, but kind of giving her some more time to adjust to VPK, kind of grow out of this toddler phase a little bit more, and then we could always reassess in a year or two with a repeat Vanderbilt screen. So I thought this was an interesting case just because I haven't always heard about ADHD and autism spectrum disorder manifesting in females. And I found it especially interesting when they were so young, kind of teasing out what was normal childhood toddler behavior from true like repetitive behaviors of autism or hyperactivity as well.
Thank you, Dr. Oberon, for utilizing that case to help describe the difference between ADHD and autism spectrum disorder. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
Hi, yes, it's Dr. Hassan. Excellent presentation and kind of showing the differences between autism.